PDF the last Monday evening. We were talking about it. So without any further talks, first PDF is on.
Hello. Okay, so I'm always very nervous, so please help me with asking questions or something. PDF is two things. It's a graphics model and it's a document format. I will explain to you PDF. I mean, everybody here uses PDF, everybody knows it, but the details are interesting. And I learned that many people know already the details very much, so I don't know if it's very much new for you.
Where do you think we go?
Well, then, yeah, you're here, so you will learn more than you probably want to know. So, graphics. To me, PDF is mostly a graphics format. And it's two-dimensional vector graphics, so we're not talking about bitmaps, we're not talking about 3D, this is all completely different. And we talk about a specific vector graphics model, so no behavior or topographics, it's the mathematical form of vector graphics. It basically is the old PostScript format. And basically, vector graphics of this style means Adobe, and basically this means this is the dominant format for many years. There's no competitor. This is all we know. It's an SVG. In any kind of vector graphics format, it's the same model. Basically, it uses paths to define lines, areas. You can use paths for clipping, and you use coordinate transformations to fill your space with things. It's all question.
Does it fit into HTML5?
I don't know.
Because now you have to reference HTML.
Yeah, but I'm sure it's modeled after SVG, and SVG is modeled after PostScript, and this was all mentioned by Adobe, and it's all the same stuff, basically. Yeah. So I hope that they have this kind of graphics model because this is very powerful. Extremely powerful. Maybe one word about pixel graphics. In the end, everything has to be broken down to pixel graphics because all our devices are pixels. The screens, the printers, they use all pixels, and to transform the mathematical description of graphics into pixels is a really hard job. In PostScript, that was called the RIP, the raster image processor, which had to really calculate where which pixel gets which color. You notice from smoothing, this is a hard thing, transparency is hard. Now I learned that from this talk from LMK and Jazeera, which Bert showed that you can do it even simpler. This RIP is actually a one-page code that does all the transformation from mathematics into pixels. I was very impressed. So to me, it was always like the virtual machine for graphics, the RIP. Okay. Anyway, so I'm not talking about the RIP. I'm just talking about the mathematical level. while PostScript was the dominant model all the time for many years, it has been superseded by PDF. PDF is now the new format which gets developed further. For example, transparency is new. Transparency is important more and more. And PostScript doesn't have transparency. And it's very difficult to do that. PDF has transparency. And it's still evolving to add more and more of this interesting concept. Okay, that's PDF. PDF is graphics. But PDF is also documents. it defines documents in an abstract way and abstracts from operating systems and printers. Fonts are embedded. So I was thinking, what was before PDF? I mean, how did we do that? Did we send Word documents around and then try to show them and the fonts were installed and they were all developed differently and we can reproduce them on print? I don't know, it's very strange. But with PDF, you really have a absolutely reliable and useful tool in the reproduction of graphical content. On top of that, Adobe modeled documents as objects. And I think they did it in a very intelligent way and in a very rich way. So a lot of information can be put into documents, not just the visual content, but the content can be linked, it can be referenced in all kinds of places. So you all know that from Acrobat, where you have a table of contents and you can jump from one place to another. They more and more incorporated other formats. Now you have video in there and 3D and what. So any information you could put on print or on a screen, you probably could do it in the PDF. Before PDF, in the professional printing industry, they used always PostScript because PostScript has the rich graphics model and it can be reproduced properly, more or less. So the experts will know, will shiver with overprint. This is really horrible because everything, everybody does it differently. But PostScript was a programming language. It's a full-blown programming language. You can do anything there. It's actually fun to send a tiny little PostScript program to the printer to have it compute something very interesting. But it, of course, led to a lot of inconsistencies and problems in the production process. So PDF explicitly doesn't have any procedural semantics. It's not an execution model at all. It's just a description, purely. That's of course not entirely true because in PDF there's PostScript lurking around everywhere in some corners and actually there are some interpreted things. So PDF is standardized. This is a nice thing. So it's an ISO standard. It's PDF 1.7, corresponding to Acrobat 8, and it's the last standard which is published because all the subsequent standards or enhancements will be extensions of the standard. So the standard is hopefully, oh, Bruce, please.
When did this version of the standard start?
2008.
Oh yes.
But you're right, there are several versions, and actually the one you want to download is a draft version, which is identical to the ISO standard. But anyway, ISO standards normally cost money, and they cost quite a bit of money. But Adobe pushed through that ISO doesn't charge for this standard, so you can freely download it and use it. It's really nice because they encourage writing readers and writers, and it's really nice. But it's big. So 750 pages, that was always like a deterrent for me to implement it, although I really wanted that for years. And it mentions 79 indispensable references. That means other standards you have to know when you want to do PDF properly. So for example, there's XML, fonts, color, 3D, of course the new stuff, video, pixel formats and things, JavaScript, so I don't know, all the standards we know which have anything to do with visual or informatics is probably needed for PDF. But it's really well written, I find, most of the parts, especially the basic parts. There are also parts which are really badly written, but the important parts are really, really well written, and it's recommended that you just take a look at what you can learn about graphics and how to do things. And actually, if you want to use the software, you need that. So, just software will not be for you to just do graphics. I decided to open source it because well, PDF is important, I find. Almost all That's the standard format which least of trouble to reproduce or send away to exchange. So especially smaller programs should use PDF as output format. So it should be not too difficult. Then PDF is there. The specification is free. It's encouraged to use it, to really make use of it for any purpose you like. But it's big. So I do just my little part. I do vector graphics for newspapers. And I don't care about bitmaps, I don't care about video, I don't care about interactive features. But when I open source it, you could add all this very nicely if you want. So, but the basic foundation, I think it's good to have it available. So I'm publishing that as MIT, and I would be happy if that could be ported to other small talks or just used. Okay, now let's get to the good. So, PDF. There are basically three layers. So the outer skin, which is pretty simple, is the file format. Support update, I will explain that briefly. Then we have an interesting object model. And remember, it's a descriptive model. It has no semantics of execution. So I will talk about this. And then the core layer of all this is the graphics. You have the vector graphics, text and fonts, and transparency. And I will talk about that. So, a PDF looks like this, very simple. It has a head. PDF 1.4, as it says here. This is required, and the version needs to be with the first thing you read of this file. Then there come another list of objects. They always look like this. They have a number, the object number, a generation number, that. Starts with the keyword object, has something in there, end object, and then the next one. So just an unordered list of objects. Then we have the reference table, where all the objects are listed with their position in the file. So, I don't know where it starts, but say this is object number 5, and it says on byte position 81 of the file, starts this object. So it's very easy for this table. You can just jump to the right spot of the file, read this object, and you're done. In the end, there's a trailer, which has a reference to the root. That's important. That's the root of the whole document. So, that comes back later. And it gives you the size, how many objects are there. Then comes the starting thread. So this is the position of the starting of the reference table. So when you read the PDF, you start at the end. Very interesting. So you take that number, jump to the reference table, load that somewhere, see the trailer, see the root, find the object, and then you're in there. So it's really simple. It's designed to do updates. For example, you can have a PDF, which can be signed even, so no bits should be ordered, and you can annotate it or extend it or make a new version of it. That means, just for that moment, this second number here in this object is the generation. So that marks what version of this object is. So you can override objects. These overwritten objects or new objects would be appended to the original file after the xref reference, and then a new small xref table for just these objects is appended. That's it. You have an update of the file without changing the original. Everything original is still there. Of course, you can do that many times. It's very intelligent. Okay, so my implementation can read any valid PDFs. So, I mean, this file format, any of you could do that in a day, it's no problem. I can do these updates, I can read these updates, as many of you want. There's also some special objects that will come briefly later to call object streams. So you don't have to be subversive about these objects, you can put them in a stream. And then you have a special reference table which is called a reference stream. So I'm going to read all these. But when I write objects, I just write a new file. All the objects, one list, one reference table. So what I can do, I mean, that's what I do. What you could do is you could recreate the extract table, because the extract table is not really useful. It's not necessary. It's just a shortcut. If you have a corrupted PDF file without an extract table, you can just read the list of objects, note the position in the file, and then recreate the extract table. There's no big deal about it. So, but I'm not doing it. I don't need it. So, but it would be an easy thing to add. I'm not doing updates of PDFs. So again, would be immediately bad, but not needing it. There's a special thing. So if you have a really big PDF, for example, the specification itself is of course a PDF, and it's 8.7 megabytes. When you want to browse that briefly on the web, it's really hard to just download all that to find the end, to just get started with the file. So they have a special format for linearizing PDFs so that you really get the first things you want to see first and so on. But I don't even know how that works. I don't need it. So, but go ahead. It's probably very easy to go ahead. Questions? I found it. I'm done with that. Okay. The object model. With, of course, some basic things. We have no true and false, which is cool. We have numbers, but they're just simple numbers. Integers and reals with 38 digits, max, something like that. It's enough for most purposes. We have strings in various forms. So normally it's just a breakfast string, but you can have special things in there like a new line. You can have hexadecimal encoded characters in there, or you can have hexadecimal characters altogether. These are all valid strings. Also, the encoding of the string is important. Usually you use PDF-DOC, which is a simple encoding. You can use the COM encoding for a string when it's printed, or you can use Unicode. So those are all valid options. Interesting is, for example, date. Date is a string. So there's no date class or time class. It's just a date. But it's a UTC string, which is quite handy, just a timestamp in the time zone. So it's a nice thing to do. Then we have names. This is just like symbols, almost. Names start with a slash, and then zero or more space characters. You can have some hexadecimal characters in there encoded like this. And this breaks, for example, that the array corresponds to the strings in Smalltalk. Just up here. Anyway, these are names. Names are unique in the system. You can use them to reference things. We have arrays, also very familiar. This is an array with three elements. A number, a string, and another array with a symbol. Nothing spectacular. More interesting are dictionaries. Dictionaries start with these signs up there. Then they have, as keys, they have names, always. Only names, nothing else. You cannot use numbers or strings or anything, just names. And then some arbitrary value behind. So it's an unordered collection. Just like our dictionaries, as we know it. It has unique names as keys, just as we know it, so you cannot have multiple keys, multiple same keys, which is sometimes handy, but just what we have in our dictionaries. The values are either objects, any objects or references. Here, by the way, it's a reference. It says a reference to the six object number 6, the little canopy value, and this kind of structure is the root of all the objects in PDF. So basically, the rest of what comes is special dictionaries with special keys, special attributes. That's the definition of the object in PDF. So very simple, very easy. One exception, one very interesting thing we don't have in Smalltalk, which we should have in Smalltalk, which is nice, strings. It's basically a dictionary with the predefined key length and arbitrary data in a block. And arbitrary means unlimited. Unlimited, so gigabytes, terabytes, if you want. That's it. Nice thing about streams is you can filter. You can apply filters. The most used one is plain decode. It's the Zeppelin plate encoding scheme. But you can also cascade them. You can encode them in various ways. For example, this one is first plain decode and then encrypt. Or the other way around. I don't know. But it's very nice to cascade these filters. Okay, I mentioned extra streams about object streams, so they're kind of handy to make it a little more compact if necessary. Okay. The filters. These are all the filters defined. There's a lot of compression. Flake code is the most useful, and I implemented that. The other one, LZW decode, is not used as I saw much. Then this bundling code is mostly used for black and white pictures. This is the FATS decoding. Bruce knows about this. He did this. He implemented this actually in this PDF implementation. Then we have something other for black and white pictures, JPEGs. And of course, you have crypt, very important, so PDFs can be encrypted. for development, I don't know why, but there's these ASCII hex decode things. These are implemented too because they're easy and it's good to write test cases for them. In Smalltalk, I implemented these objects as real separate objects, separate classes. So I didn't try to use symbols as names or the Smalltalk strings as PDF strings, but I just really did them separately. I have a namespace PDF, and there you have class string, a class dictionary, class array, and they're all the PostScript semantics, the PDF semantics, and not Smalltalk. All PostScript objects implement content, and in the content is, of course, the Smalltalk object. So dictionary has a dictionary, number is a number, and so on. The smaller objects can be converted to a PDF by just saying as PDF. Namespaces. Namespaces is a difficult topic in some circles, but I really like them because I can stay as close to the specification as possible. So I can use the word dictionary as it is in the specification. And I really like that. It makes things much clearer. Instead of guessing, oh, is it now a PDF string, or is it a CHPDF version 2 string? So it's just a string. If you see it in the documentation, in the specification of string, then you look in the class hierarchy browser string, that's the one. Some classes may be realized. So for example, name, number, boolean, they're really, really similar to the smaller objects. But I didn't do that. So that's actually a boolean, PDF boolean. This is not a boolean. I'm undecided about that. And, for now, it's a real clean separation between these object models. But for performance, it may be necessary to analyze a couple of them. And And yes, it can be confusing. Yes, I have two dictionaries and there I have strings. I always type string new if I want to something, and then it's a PDF string. Ah, okay, now I use byte string new or array new. You need to have core.array new, stuff like that. So what I implemented is that I can read all object types. I can write any objects, and I can use flaky code for reading and writing. That's very handy. But I don't do it any picturing cut strings. I don't need bitmap pictures in my application, and so I do implement them. Anybody's welcome to do that. It's not difficult, but you just have to study the special picture format to put it in there. Yes?
Can you export the properties of password protection?
Encrypted PDFs encrypt only strings, interestingly. And the streams are from the strings. So all streams and all strings are encrypted. But the whole structure, all the other objects, like dictionary times, tables, I don't know if they are encrypted, but you see all the structure plain. Just the strings are encrypted. So it depends on what you need. If you need string information, then you are like the structure information you get. You know how many pages there are, you know, and I don't know what things are there. Is that answering your question?
Do you have to set the functions for collection?
Properties for protection.
Yeah, there are
certain different kinds of code prints. Yeah, this is all encrypted PDF. So when you encrypt a PDF, there are two levels. First is the user level. You normally can see these things. You can open them, see them, and maybe print them. And the password is actually in the PDF. So if you implement this encryption algorithm, which is documented, fine, so I just didn't do that, but if you implement that, you can read out this password and then get into the content. There's other information like the permissions that you can do with PDF, if you can print it, if you can modify it, if you can do stuff like that. That's of course also encrypted, and there's a second password for the author, an author part, which is not the PDF. So, if you don't have that, you cannot change anything there, which is okay. So it gives reasonable protection for the actual property. Okay, but I didn't do anything about the encryption. You will see, I can see encrypted files, but I don't decrypt them. So with this knowledge, with this level, the second level, right, we're not in core yet, we can speak PDF. We have our domain image. So basically, we can forget about Smalltalk and just express everything we want in PDF. Note down our dictionaries and arrays and numbers and strings and so on. No, it's just the entry. Okay, quick. One part of the object model is the object model for documents. It's quite elaborately defined. For example, from root you come to an object called a catalog, and it has pages, and it has many, many other things which might be interesting. But pages is required, and the type catalog is required, and from there on you go to all your pages. Is also required for the document. Needs a media box to know how big it is. It has a content, which where actually the real graphics happens. And anything the content needs, like fonts or images or color spaces or whatever, is stored separately in a resource dictionary. marked with this type of object to have it there. And so it's implicitly typed, you can change the object when you assign it, and then get the benefit of a nice type object. Each object and attribute has a version. PDF went through many versions and introduced new objects, new versions, new attributes, and they're all marked with versions. So if you have the requirement to only produce PDFs not bigger than 1.3, then you know what features you can use and which not. And this is important to find out the feature with the minimal version which needs to be put in the header of the PDF file. And it is well documented. Okay, I will show you that. It's nicer to show you. I will just show you the explorer. So my implementation is basically reading these PDF objects and being able to create them and dump them to a file. But I also wrote a little explorer where you can actually find out about PDFs, see the objects, and know what's going on inside. So when you load the stuff into the image, you get these two new things. In the PDF Explorer, looks like this, and you can just erase it here. The minimal thing we saw before. Not visible at all. It should be this type thing, should be green because it's required and it's there. Okay, just a little bit of explanation. You can see it better here. That's actually a really bad one because it has errors. Let's take the specification. Because I need them to display stuff. So it's read lazily. You can read really big files, but only pick the objects you need. You have the trailer, which we know already. Okay, it's a number of objects. You have the route, the catalog, the pages. So you have a kind of a tree structure. You can arrange them. You have lots of pages. And here we have 700 pages, and they arrange them in 10 views. The page then has content, has resources, and then some information about things. Rotate, for example, do you know that? I mean, the tools out there which lets you rotate a page, that you move horizontally, and then stay like this, like here. just a brief look at these things. Content is a stream, and it's flake decoded, of course. A little bit about this explorer. So, to understand PDF, there are hundreds of objects and thousands of attributes. To understand them, I annotated all the attributes and objects with the documentation from the specification. So, what you see, the page contents is of type content or of area type contents, which is an area of content. Or it can be an encrypted string. Fine. So then the documentation from the specification. Here you see the object actually, and here you see it's PDF 1.0. Then you see the attributes which are in the file. So you don't see it, but this one is green and it's required. That's here. So a stream always has a length. Always needs a length, otherwise it doesn't have a stream. It can have filters. And then here, this is gray. Plus gray, that means these attributes are defined in the spec, but they are not present. So it just have length and filter. And okay, but interesting here is also that all these attributes have their version annotated. And when you look internally in the stream, it looks a lot like PostScript. I'll come to that later. I'm almost finished.
Yes.
So, what I can do with my implementations, I can infer the implemented types. So, when you read objects, the types are inferred. And when you have the types, you will get the documentation, the versions, and all this added information. I can detect the type errors. I can infer the version, which is very handy, and show the documentation. Not all the restrictions which are mentioned in the specification written verbally are implemented. There's some strange ones, like one of these three attributes has to be present if this is a PDF higher than 1.5 or something like that. So this kind of stuff is not implemented, but a lot of them are. What would be nice would be to be able to edit the attributes in this. You can't do that. So just running out of time, so just quickly about graphics. Graphics, this content stream, is just a stream of operators with parameters. So instead of PostScript writing programs which produce graphics, you just have a sequence of operations. On a page, there's a graphics state involved. It holds all the parameters which affect drawing operations. For example, line width, colors, stuff like that. There are 28 attributes defined, and they can be nested, which is kind of nice. This was the same in PostScript, so you can add another graphic state on top, modify the graphic state, draw something, and then just drop it, and all those attributes are gone, and you're back to your old state. There are 73 operations defined, 7 groups to manipulate the graphic state, to do color, markings, path clipping, and so on. So